All right, everyone, welcome back to Cody's Lab. As you can see, we're finally back inside the mine. So it's been about 2 weeks since I've been here last. Let's go see if those lights are even still on. Looks like the cable's still intact. Yeah, it's on. How about that?
The mushrooms are growing. Yeah, there's some mushrooms in there. Should I try one of them? See how they taste? Yeah, here we go. Yeah, it's definitely a mushroom. A oyster mushroom variety. Yeah, not bad. You want to try one, Canyon?
I'm good.
She'll pass.
Oh yeah, look at that. They're actually growing. Maybe a little too much, actually. There's lots of lettuce. I should have planted fewer seeds in there. Yeah, I definitely should go through and thin these out. See, has that one got something? Nope. Should I try these? Yeah. Radish. Sprout. Grew without sunlight. They're definitely growing slower because of the cold, but they are growing. I think I'm going to leave this plastic thing off and then put this light up a little higher next time. Yeah, and then we'll come back in a week and see if they grow even more. Alright, so I'm digging out a little spot here so I can put the plants up against the side of the cave so we can actually have room to walk and stuff. Also, this will get the light up so that it's above the plants, so the plants have room to grow. Oops.
Did you whistle?
No.
Who's here?
Well, what do you think? Precarious enough? See, I ended up using that board. Yeah, if there's an earthquake, it'll fall, but otherwise I don't think anything's going to cause it to fall. I'll build something better later. Purple, green. Purple, green. As you can see, I went through and I thinned the radishes a little bit because they were going to be way too crowded to produce any sort of bulbs. But there it is. It's all set up. The peas down the middle. It's going to be interesting to see if they'll grow. Hopefully I don't have this light too far away. But since the light is pretty flat with the direction of the light, I don't think it really matters. But I guess we're going to find out. So I guess I'll just leave this alone for now. So Kenyon and I have been playing this game called Firewatch. And in that game, they have radios and the main character is talking to another ranger named Delilah. Talks to her on the radio constantly. And I have a similar radio here. Okay, I can hear she's actually ringing me. Hello, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
All right, so she can hear me here. So there's a part in the game, pretty early on, where he goes inside of a cave, and he can still hear Delilah on the radio. So I'm going to recreate that now. Can you hear me now?
Yep.
All right. Can you hear me now? I think we lost her. Hello, can you hear me? Hello? Okay.
Hello?
Alright, I think I actually lose her right here at the front of the mine. It looks like going inside of a cave is definitely going to block the signal from a radio. So a guy sent me this laser rangefinder and he wanted me to review it. I'll put his name on the screen somewhere as well as in the description. Now, so this thing has a laser beam that comes out. I don't know if you can see it over there. It's actually pretty hard to see in the daylight. And I push this button again, blinks a few times, and it tells me how far away it was. It's actually pretty cool. The only thing I don't like about it is that, like I said, you can't see the beam in the daylight, and if it's too bright, it actually just gives me an error reading. Or actually gives me a number even though it's way farther away than that.
But it definitely works pretty good in the dark, and I've been playing with it. And it's pretty accurate. Let's measure across this frame here, because I know how far apart this is. There we go. It says, you okay?
I got rock rain.
All right, so that tells me it's 1.047 meters across.
Can I look at that again?
Okay. It's right there, the last reading. And it keeps the readings in the queue so that I can go back to them later. Now, let's actually measure across here. So that's 41 inches. I'm sure you guys can do the math. Since this thing is pretty good for working in the dark, I thought that I might actually measure how far back the mine goes. So I got the laser beam back there. Can you see it? Unfortunately, the tunnel curves, so we'll have to take several measurements. Set this right in the middle, line it up. I'm gonna put it right on that rock. It's right there. Okay. Yeah, so 9.8 meters there. All right, so I got my Brunton compass here. That's actually, and I'm actually gonna take a piece of this graph paper in my field notebook, and I'm actually gonna make a scale model of the mine. You know, like a scale drawing, I mean. Anyway, let's pop this open. See what orientation this mine's going in at. So that's north right there. Now I turn it into the direction of the mine. Looks like the mine's going at 300 degrees northwest. All right, I'll mark that on my paper. Okay, so I've positioned the graph so that 300 degrees is directly this direction. And you can see I've marked off where these posts are. And each box this way is half a meter, and each box this way is 1 meter. And here's our 9.8 meter mark, which is the center of the tunnel over there. And I marked also where the tunnel begins to curve and where it begins to curve on this side as well. All right, and I was able to do all that while standing right here. So this thing is pretty nice in that regard. I don't have to like string the tape measure out.
All right, so this is the rock I was using. I'm gonna set this here, measure across the tunnel. Gives me 1.39 meters. So the tunnel's a little wider here, and I thought that would be true. So I go across this, I'm gonna measure 1 1/3 meters, and then connect the dots. Very nice. Now, we're measuring this way. It's gonna be interesting, because I got a straight shot all the way back to that shovel from here.
Pointing the compass at the shovel, I've got 255 degrees. See, if it was 260, that'd be 40. So yeah, it's a 45 degree turn there.
So that's the far wall, actually.
All right, so I'm just working on this here. I took a few more measurements. You can see the measurements I've done. So the far wall on this side of the tunnel was 18.4 meters away. The center of the tunnel was the 17.8. And on this side, was 17 and a half. And then the point where the tunnel actually starts to curve away and go back around this way was 13.05 meters. So I'm measuring these out now.
So that's just another 1.8 meters to the end of the tunnel there, which is good because that's all I've got left to write on my little graph thing here.
All right, so that's 1.8, so it's just a little bit above this. Let's measure a width here. All right, so here we are. Here's the finished graph. I don't know how well you can see it in here, but there it is. Should be all to scale. Kind of wish I would have had this back when I was beating on the ground with a hammer. Maybe I'll try the hammer thing again over the exact right spot and see if it'll be any louder.
All right, it's been a week and we just came up. Looks like the solar panel's down, actually, so that's no good. I'm gonna go look at that.
Down here on the footprint. As you can see, the cows have been up here. So the cows must have pushed it over. But the solar panel's fine. I'll just stand it back up. I'm just gonna tie it down with some ropes for now, but I'll definitely build a structure up here, like out of 2x4s or something. Make sure the cows don't tip it over again. Yeah, maybe that'll stop them from rubbing up against it. All right, so here's the mine. And
There's a feed bag in the entrance here.
I didn't bring a feed bag up, did you?
No.
It must have blown in by the wind. It's kind of weird that it'd end up here. We're miles from the house.
Yep. Maybe a cow carried it.
Yeah, I wouldn't put that past them. Well, plants are still alive. Mushrooms are bigger. The radishes actually look like they've even grown a little bit.
I suspect they've been without light for a few days, so. Yeah, look at those mushrooms, they're even bigger. Very nice. There, so mushrooms will actually grow in here, that's good to know.
Are they what smells like foot?
Do they smell like feet?
Something in here does.
Maybe it is them.
Open them up, let me smell them. No, it's not them. Maybe it's just you.
Yeah, it probably is.
Well, unfortunately, I still don't have those assays back. It's been like 4 weeks, almost a month, since I sent the samples in. And they told me it'd be 10 business days, but I still haven't received word from it. So maybe I'll go ahead and call them and see if I can get any information on it on Monday. So unfortunately, that means we're not going to be doing too much here today. One thing I wanted to mention was people keep recommending I use dynamite or nitroglycerin to blast, and that probably would definitely work, but I'm not certain it's very legal to actually make dynamite and use it. I think I might actually have to have a license even if I make it myself. Currently, I can use black powder. Black powder's fine, but those higher order explosives are a little bit, there's some regulation to it. I might be able to use ammonium nitrate tannerite, stuff that I've been using in a lot of my videos. The only problem with that is you really need like a 2-inch hole to get it to explode real well. If anything smaller than that, and it'll explode for a little ways, but it won't go all the way down the hole, because ammonium nitrate has a very small minimum diameter for the blast wave to be able to generate and propagate. But anyway, let's go find something else to do.
All right, so got me a roll of pipe here. Now it's only 1 inch in diameter, but it is pressure rated, and it's very, very flexible, so I think it'll be pretty good to have this run all the way to the back of the mine. It'd be my emergency air supply. Also, I think I'll put a blower or something on this end so I could blow air in there. You know, it's not very big, I can't blow a lot of air, but it's better than nothing. Alright, so I got this all strung out, and I'm just going to tow it into the mine.
Grab a stake into the rock and get a piece of wire. Tie the pipe to the stake. Yeah, it won't hold it really well, but at least it'll hold it up out of the way when we're going by with the wheelbarrow and stuff. Alright, so there's the last one. And there's where the end of the pipe comes. Point the light and camera over here. So it's not quite to the back of the mine, but there it is. It gets us most of the way. If you look over here, I can blow air through it, so I think it'll work. Eventually I'd like to dig a trench in the actual floor of the cave, like down in here, and bury the pipe there. That way, if the mine collapses, it's not going to like cause it to fall off the wall and then pinch it. It's going to just put more dirt on top of what's already there. But this will work for now.
All right. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I don't know if the camera can hear it. Really?
Yeah.
I'm actually kind of far away from the tube.
Yeah, it carries the sound really well, don't it?
That's crazy.
So here's the map of the mine that we made. As you can see, I imported this data into Google Earth. Here's north, and here's that tree that the solar panel's tied to. And as it turns out, here's the rock that I was beating on in the last video. And here's the second one. So either I was really lucky, or I was pretty good at eyeballing where to do it, because this is actually pretty close to being right above the end of the mine. Anyway, it was really curious as to why they turned the tunnel like they did. I mean, why didn't they just go straight into the mountain? Say they were actually going for this spot here.
Well, if I put in a blue line showing where the tunnel would have been if they went straight into the mountain, you can see it's actually much longer. So somebody knew what they were doing when they were digging this hole.
Well, unfortunately, that's all the time I got for today. But hope you all enjoyed. I'll see you next time.